people are happy to mute, we might get our service underway. So welcome to everybody out there in cyberspace. Hope you, like us who did the tennis, can stay awake, see how we go. If we poke and prompt each other, we should be all right. Anyway, we're going to kick off this morning with listening to Love Divine. Okay, for those who are watching back on the YouTube later on in the day, something went on with the projector at church, so it's not quite up to sync, but see how we go. Anyway, our opening reading this morning is Psalm 16, which I think Craig will share with you in a moment. There we go. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones, in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Next slide. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures evermore. I thought that was a good psalm to sort of focus on this morning. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. Yes, things are not going exactly as we would like at the moment, but we are part of a bigger plan and things are going exactly according to God's plan. So we are in a good place, and I think it's good to remind ourselves of that. Let's pray. Father, thank you that our glorious inheritance is indeed in your hands. Father, thank you that that cannot be shaken. Father, thank you that you are in control. Despite what we see in our world, people running in to and fro trying to work out which way next, you are in control. Father, we pray for those for whom this is a difficult time. We pray that this morning they might be able to take just some time out of their worries and connect with you and your people and be blessed by being in your presence. In your name we pray. Amen. Our second song this morning to listen to is And Can It Be?
Thank you. good morning, everyone. It's good to see so many people on there this morning. Just a couple of announcements, because most things obviously is in recess. And the only thing really happening during the week is the prayer meeting, which is, once again, that will be via Zoom. So if you haven't, you don't normally go to that, and you would like to be Zoom in, connect to it, maybe give Joshua a ring, and he can send you an invite for it. So that's this Friday at 8:30 a.m. Apart from that, advance notice, the Base Camp Men's Convention is Saturday the 14th of August, so we're really hoping that will go ahead. And also the church mini market, and that's quite a bit of information in there, in the bulletin, as there has been, I think, last couple of weeks. There's a new request, can anyone provide us with a coffee machine for our morning teas? So keep that in mind too, if you happen to have a spare one or one you can lend for that. So I don't think there's much else there. The COVID updates, you probably all know by now that it will continue being the Zoom service. So it's great if we can keep joining together as a family for that. Okay, well that's it for me at the minute.
Thanks, John. I think at the very least with Base Camp, we'll be allowed to watch on our own TVs in our own homes, but that won't be quite the same. So hopefully something better than that is still able to happen come the 14th. Got a month, so here's hoping. I'm just going to pray for the our missionaries and for the offering as well. Father, we thank you for your multiple blessings. Father, even in lockdown, we are so very blessed with all the things that we have and the way that we are looked after. And we just praise you and thank you for that. And Father, we pray that as we bring a portion of our offerings to you this week, that it would be done so with a willing heart and would be used for your glory here and further abroad. And Father, we continue to pray for our missionaries as they serve you in often very challenging situations. We pray for them as they not only go about their daily lives, but also as they manage COVID, often in situations that is far more challenging than ours. Father, bless them as they serve you in this way. Father, water and grow the seed that they plant so that it may really blossom into amazing churches and amazing missions for you in many places around our world. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Okay, our first reading is Romans chapter 7, kicking off at verse 13 and continuing on to chapter 8, verse 10, and I'll be bringing that to you. Did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold under sin. For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not know what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be the law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. And moving on to chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Okay, we're going to listen again to Jesus Shall Reign. Okay, Daphne's going to unmute herself and burst forth with a children's talk.
Okay. can't do the things you want to do, and you can't meet with your friends, and you can't do the things you would like to do because it's still holidays and you have to stay home. But you can stop and think and pray and ask God to fill you with the fruit of the Spirit, so that instead of being grumpy and complaining, you can be joyful and peaceful and kind. It's tough to do it on our own strength, but God will help us every day to do the things He wants us to do, to live His way. So I'm going to pray for us now, and I'm especially going to pray for Tanya, because she has to still do the HSC during this time. So let's pray. Father, please help us to remember that You are a God who loves us very, very much. Please help us to, when we are feeling grumpy and miserable and things are going wrong, that You will fill us with the fruit of Your Spirit, that You'll help us to be joyful and peaceful and kind and gentle, even when we don't feel like it. And Father, I pray especially for Tanya today, as she has to do the HSC in these interesting circumstances. Father, we pray that You'll help her to keep at it, to keep working, to keep plotting, not be discouraged, and we do pray that You'll help her do the best that she can. And we pray for all the teachers and all the other people who are working in schools, that You'll help them to do all the things that they have to do well. And I do pray this in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Can anyone hear me out there? Thank you. Okay, our second Bible reading is Acts chapter 14, verses 8 to 18, and Enid's going to bring that to us. So unmute Enid and away we go.
Now at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. He was crippled from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul speaking, and Paul looked intently at him and seeing him. Said in a low voice, "Stand upright on your feet." And he sprang up, began walking. And when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying, "Praise the Simeon. The gods have come down to us in the likeness of men." Barnabas, the Zeus, and Paul, Hermes, the Pisces, the chief speaker, and the priest of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance to the book, the garden to the. How do I get this up? To the gates and not in earth to offer sacrifice to the prayers. And when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul heard of it, they tore their garments and rushed out of the crowd, crying out, "Now, why are you doing these things? We also are of like nature with you, and with the good news, that you should turn from the divine things to the Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea, and all that is in them. In past generations, he led all the nations to walk in their own ways, yet he did not leave himself without witness, for he did good by giving you rain from heaven and food for seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. Even with these words, they scarcely restrain the people from offering sacrifice to them."
Thanks, Enid. Come to a prayer time now. Oops, I can take that off. Come to a prayer time now, so I'll pray. Let's pray. Father, we thank You that despite all that is going on, we can meet this way. Thank You that we have the capacity to still enjoy fellowship and to hear Your word sung, read, and to hear it spoken about. Father, we thank You for that. Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters who are in more difficult circumstances. We pray that they would be working out ways this morning where they can have a good fellowship with people and a good time in Your word. Father, we pray for our community. There are people impacted by this in many ways, whether it's to do with sickness, whether it's to do with their work, whether it's juggling next week, having work commitments and also children at home. Father, so many things that people need to manage. Not being able to visit elderly or unwell relatives. Father, so much going on. We pray that you would bless people. You pray that you would give them opportunity to do what they need to do, to be able to manage the things they need to manage, to be able to get the balance right with all that is happening. Father, we pray for those in positions of authority in our businesses and workplaces, that they would be understanding of the needs of their employees, and that they would be able to show grace and understanding during this time. But Father, we pray most of all that this virus would get back in check, that the things that need to happen would happen, so that our society can reopen and get back to some semblance of normality sooner rather than later. Father, we pray that you would give great wisdom to those making decisions, that they would be able to seek the truth of what is going on, and that they would be able to act on that, that they could put aside politics, that they could put aside popularity, that they could simply find the truth in this situation and bring that to bear. Father, we do pray for the incredible pressure that our leaders are under. Father, we know that leaders are put in those positions by you, and so we ask just your extra blessing on them at this time, that they would be able to carry the workload that is upon them, that they would be surrounded by people with good counsel, and that they would be drawing on your strength, Father, for getting through a situation that they really won't get through on their own strength. Father, we thank you that your word continues to go out. Father, we again mention our missionaries and others that we know who are working all around this world in challenging situations to share your word. Father, we pray for those who cannot even speak your name, yet somehow are getting alongside people and showing them you through their lives, through what they do, through how they live. Father, we pray that your spirit would be at work in such places and that you would be doing amazing things. Father, we pray for places where there is active opposition to your word going out, even in our own country where certain states are pushing back very hard against scripture continuing and churches having a public voice. Father, we ask that you would stay those that would try and halt the work of your word. Father, we ask that you would thwart their plans and that your word would continue to go out into communities and societies unhindered. And again, Father, we ask that your spirit would go ahead of it and work in the lives of those who hear it. And Father, as we gather as our church this morning in this small way, we pray that we would always be a church that focuses on you and your word and getting that out into our community. Father, thank you for the plans that are made to do that more this year, and we pray that you would bring those plans to fruition and that they would show great results for you and for your name. And Father, I pray for John this morning. Thank you for his love for your word and his love for your people, and pray that you would guide him as he shares your word with us this morning, that we would listen with open and willing hearts to learn anew what you would have us learn. In your son's name we pray. Amen. I'll hand over to John.
Well, good morning, everyone. Firstly, I must apologise. There's no slides to look at, so you just have to put up with my voice. It's great to see that we got all 18 people there, so it's really great to see you. I can see your little pictures of you on there. So just wave. Everyone wave. Good. You're all there. Okay. I'm calling this Apostle Paul. What can or should we learn about Paul? And it's interesting to see the differences between Saul and Paul, even though we're talking about the same person. Now, if we talk about Saul, Saul was born into a wealthy Jewish family who lived in the Roman province of Syria, Cilicia. Saul's father was a Roman citizen and a citizen of his home city, Tyrus. Thus, Saul also inherited both of these citizenships. Saul, as a teenager, studied under the leading scholar of the day, Rabbi Gamaliel. Apologise if it's not wrong pronunciation. At Jerusalem, Saul was one of the best pupils of Gamaliel and became a fully pledged Pharisee. He took the lead in the violent suppression of the new sect of Nazarenes. It is interesting to see this same Gamaliel is the one who saved the apostles from certain death when they were being questioned by the Sadducees in the Sanhedrin of the Council of Justice. He warned the men should take care what they did with the apostles. He told them to leave them alone. They may be oppressing, opposing God if what they say about Jesus being the Messiah is true, unlike the many claims made by others before him. I wonder what Saul would have thought if Saul had been present when Gamaliel made this speech. He would have wondered why Gamaliel stopped the apostles from being killed. We first get to meet Saul in the Bible when Stephen is stoned to death in Acts 7. The witnesses of Stephen's death laid down their garments at the feet of the young man named Saul. And in chapter 8 verse 1 adds, and Saul approved of his execution. So what does Saul say about himself? He has confidence in the flesh. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Saul was a highly focused and determined person. In Acts 8 verse 3, Saul was ravaging the church, entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. In Acts 26 and verse 5 to 11, we find out Saul lived as a Pharisee. He took every opportunity in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. He did this in Jerusalem. He locked up many of the saints in prison, authorized by the chief priests. He used his bait so to have believers put to death. Saul punished believers often in all the synagogues, trying to make them blame and blaspheme. He raised fury against the believers and persecuted them even to foreign cities. In Acts 9 we read, but Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. So Saul was a man to be feared by Christians. As one book puts it, Saul made havoc of the church. The more moral and intelligent a man or a woman is, the more harm they can do when controlled by Satan. But, there's always a good but God has other plans for Saul. Now, talking about Paul, the first time Saul is called Paul is in Acts 13 verse 9. And the name of Saul is not mentioned or used after this. I want to look at several things relating to Paul and what we can learn about him, about them, for ourselves. First one is Paul's conversion in Acts chapter 9. You would have to say it was dramatic. As Paul approached Damascus, suddenly a light from the heavens shone around him. Paul fell to the ground and heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Paul replied, was, who are you, Lord? He realized the voice was a divine encounter. It must have really hit Paul to the core when Jesus said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do, as well as restoring his sight. The Lord said to Ananias about Paul, go, for he, Paul, is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. And could certainly find that Paul, I should say, did suffer a lot. If you read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, 16 to 29, Paul names quite a few of the way he suffered. There's a lot more about Paul's conversion found in Acts 9, and it's really worthwhile reading the whole chapter 9, Acts 9. So what can we learn about Paul's conversion? As in many other cases, God can choose people that surprise us, or people we would not even consider as church leaders, or people who God will use for his work. People such as Moses, Jonah, David, Gideon, and of course Paul. Not everyone has such a dramatic conversion as Paul, but it's probably needed for him. He would never consider accepting and telling people about Jesus otherwise. Do you believe God has work for you to do for him? And do you feel adequate to serve our Lord and Saviour? I certainly don't, except by God's grace and Spirit. Philippians 4:13, a very well-known verse, starts, I can do all things. But if you stop there, it means you are relying on your own strength and abilities. The verse continues, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Relying on Jesus, you will be able to do things and serve God even when you feel unworthy or inadequate. He will provide all we need and even more to do his work. Number two, Paul, like us, battles with life. And the first reading we had in Romans 7, which Robert read earlier, shows us that Paul understands how we all battle with our sinful nature. Basically, it says, we do not do what we want, but do the very thing or things we hate. Paul explains, it's no longer him doing it, but the sin that dwells within him. He has the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. He finds himself doing the evil he does not want to do instead of the good he wants to do. Are we honest enough to agree with Paul? We are battling the same way. Thank goodness Paul gives us hope and the solution. In reading Romans 7:21-25, so I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? And 25 says it, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So when I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. And then it goes on, as I said, Rob read it earlier, some very reassuring verses following in Romans 8. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of spirit of life has set me free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. We walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind of the flesh is death, but to set the mind of the Spirit is life and peace. Paul explains clearly what his and our choice is in this. Mind of the flesh equals death. Mind of the Spirit, life and peace. Number three, humility of Paul. There are several examples found in the Bible for this. The second reading we had, as Enid read, was Acts 14:8-18:1. Barnabas and Paul went to Lystra, where Paul healed a man who was crippled. Paul said to the man, stand upright on your feet. And of course the result was he sprang up and began walking. The crowds of witnesses considered Paul and Barnabas were gods. The priests of Zeus then wanted to offer sacrifice with the crowds. Paul and Barnabas could have let the crowds continue treating them as gods, receiving gifts and having people worship them as such. But that did not happen. In verse 14, 18, we find the apostles Barnabas and Paul, when they knew what was going on, they tore their garments and rushed out to the crowd crying out, "Men, why are you doing these things? We are also men of like nature with you. And we bring you good news that you should turn from these vain things to a living God who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that's in them." And it goes on with that. Secondly, even though we could easily treat Paul the great apostle, in one of the books I have actually calls him the great apostle, I'm sure Paul would dispute this title. He is always pointing people to Jesus, away from himself. In 1 Corinthians 3, 1-9, gives an example of this. Paul tells the brothers at Corinth, I cannot address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. Why is this? There's jealousy and strife among you. They are saying, I follow Paul. Others say, I'm following Apollos. So he's telling them Paul and Apollos are just servants through whom they believed, as the Lord assigned to each. And their purpose was, Paul was planting, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. Paul concludes in verse 7, neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God gives the growth. And Paul continues, we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. And further on in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says about himself in verse 9, I am the least of the apostles. I'm worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. That was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach and so you believed. There's no boasting going on here, even when he is saying I'm working harder than the others. What was he explaining regarding this? He was saying that it was not I, but the grace of God that is in me. And that's really a great reminder for all preachers and leaders who are looked up to by us and others. Paul's humility is also shown by a number of people he uses in his missions and people he leaves behind in leadership roles at the places he went to. Paul could have tried to do all the work himself by himself, proclaiming Jesus is Lord and risen Saviour who came to save us from our sins. It would have been an impossible task for one person. There was a much larger area covered by the people who helped with Paul's missions. I have a book written by Paul Barnett called Paul and His Friends in Leadership. The subheading of the book is How They Changed the World. In the prefix of the book, Paul Barnett mentions there are almost 100 names associated with Paul and Acts and Paul's letters. Not all of these were close mission colleagues. 24 of the 100 we know most about in the great detail. People included in those 24 is Timothy, Paul's leading fellow worker, Priscilla and Aquila, merchants, Apollos, passionate preacher, Titus, Paul's ambassador, Philemon, house church leader, John Mark, author, Rufus, chosen in the Lord, Epaphroditus, Zechariah, Sylvanus, missionary and translator, and of course Barnabas, missionary leader. As we read through Paul's letters, we are given a picture of how Paul loved and cared for the many who helped him in his missions. They are more than just people he used for his work. I'd just like to give a couple of examples. And most of the examples, when you read through Paul's letters, usually sort of occur at the beginning of the letters. So in Romans 1 verse 8 to 12, First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will I may know at last season coming to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gifts to strengthen you. That is, that we may mutually encourage by each other's faith, both yours and mine. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 to 8, I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and knowledge. Even as the testimony about Christ is confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. In Ephesians chapter 1, 15 to 18, for this reason, because I have heard your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all saints, I do not cease to give thanks to you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. And it goes on, the list goes on, as it says, I said, if you go and read the first few verses of each book, First Thessalonians is also the same, talks about constantly mentioning you in their prayers, and for how great the work they are doing. So that's what I encourage you to read the books and look at the beginnings of them, and you'll find a lot of encouragement and how much Paul really loved and cared for them. We also need to remember Paul wrote several of his letters while in prison, such as Philemon, Colossians, Ephesians and Philippians. He also wrote to Timothy in a Roman dungeon, expecting at any time for people to come and behead him. And yet all these times he's encouraging people and saying how grateful that he is with them. Maybe it was for our purpose and for the previous generations who followed after Paul why Paul ended up in prison, giving him the time to write these encouraging letters, giving us wisdom, knowledge, warnings and instruction so we will become obedient and grow in Christian maturity. None of Paul's letters are long, a couple of 16 chapters, but most are under 8 chapters you'll find. You cannot but help to notice when reading Paul's letters the following. Paul is praying constantly for his helpers and his brothers and sisters in many regions he visited during his 3 missionary journeys. He aims to encourage, support, warn and give guidance to people, especially the ones he has left as leaders. And a great example is for Timothy. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, he says, let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. And furthermore, in chapter 6, he says, O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Avoid the irrelevant babble and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge, or by professing it, some have to swerve from the faith. Grace be with you. And just quoting from a book I've got called What the Bible is About, every step of his, that is Paul's great missionary journeys, Paul made known Christ's will with unmistakable clarity. Paul's urgency and aim to tell everyone about Jesus never wavered, no matter where he was or who he was talking to. We certainly find that in Acts 25 and 26, where Paul is before King Agrippa, II, King of Chalcis, and great-grandson of Herod the Great. Paul told him of his conversion and then went on to say to him, Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim a light, both to our people and to the Gentiles. Paul asked Agrippa, do you believe the apostles, the prophets? Agrippa replies, in a short time would you persuade me to be a Christian? And Paul replied, whether short or long, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me this day might become such as I am. There are many other examples we can learn from Paul. We need always be ready to tell others, no matter who they are, about what Jesus did for us and for them, about Jesus' death and resurrection and his obedience to his Father, our God. No one can be saved from their sins. Even when Paul was in prison at Philippi, the jailer and his family were converted by Paul's sincere message about Jesus. The jailer's question to them was, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? They replied to him and to us also, Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. The story is found in Acts 16. There is so much more about Paul and what we can learn from him. Can I urge you to read through the books written by Paul? As I mentioned, most are not very long. Meditate and pray about what Paul is saying to you from his letters. If you need encouragement, guidance, and direction with your life, read Paul's letters. To summarise, I leave you with something from an application study Bible I have. It says, God did not waste any part of Paul, his background, his training, his citizenship, his mind, or even his weaknesses. Are you willing to let God do the same for you? You'll never know all he will do with you until you allow him to have all that you are. I'll just read that again. You will never know all he will do with you and for you until you allow him to have all that you are. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for Paul. We thank you that he did so much for you after his conversion, realising that Jesus is Lord and Saviour. We think of all the sufferings he went through also. He could have lived a life of luxury and as a Pharisee, and people would look up to him, and he probably would have been well off. But he chose Jesus, which we all need to do. So we just pray that as we go away and start another week, that we do spend time reading your word, particularly the books that Paul wrote as many years ago. Because what he's saying to them certainly applies for us in this world as well. In your Son's name, amen.
Thank you, John. When you sort of summarise Paul's life like that, you really do realise just what an amazing impact and how God used him to grow the early church. We're going to finish with our final song, Oh for a Thousand Tongues.
Oh,
close with a reading from Romans chapter 15. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I think Joshua's going to come up now and press some buttons and put you into some groups and so forth. So chat on.